was actually developed to kind of fit the toy line that they had. Robotech, the show actually became a surprise success, and all of a sudden they were like, oh my goodness, you know, how do we get the licensing into the United States? This was back in the 80s, and so a lot of folks had a lot of difficulty finding these toys back at that time. And then by the time the toys came in, it was a little late in their product cycle, and then when Sentinels did work, a lot of the toys disappeared again, and then Robotech became exceptionally hard to find during the 90s. But as of late, when Robotech found new life on DVD home video, you know, the fans came back out of the woodwork with the new games, toys came back, and our new partner with the toys for the last several years has been Toynami. And they have new 30th anniversary 1-to-100 scale Transformables. These are like the original Veritex that you had back then, and they're at a more manageable 1-to-100 scale as opposed to 155 scale. The larger 155 scale toys right now, if you try to get them on eBay, they'll go for hundreds of bucks. But the 155 scale, they're at a much lower price point to make them more of an impulse buy. And one of the nice things at that scale is we have, because of the lower price, we're able to do a larger variety of all the different colors, you know, whether it's Rick's, Max, Ben's, or Roy's version. And another category that Toynami has been developing is the small blind box toys. This is at the price under 10 bucks, about $9.99, where you can get these little boxes, and the sculpting on them is really cute. It's like that super deformed style that you saw with the small Transformables from the Matchbox toys back then. And this is what the sculpting on them looked like when they were being prototyped through digital printing. And you'll notice that with the sculpting detail, they have even little gimmicks designed into them, such as the cockpit that would come out of the back of the Veritex neck that you saw in the Countdown episode when Rick destroyed Mimei's apartment. And here's what some of the finished product looked like. Now, they've got a variation of the super deformed product line. They've got the blind box figures, which have very little articulation, or they're just single-piece toys, but they're at the $9.99 price point. But they also have a more premium version, which they're calling the Ultimites. These were unveiled at the New York Toy Fair earlier this year, where they're actually posable, along with, and so they're at a higher price point, but this looks really, really well sculpted and articulated. And also plushies. For some folks it's a little bit of a head scratcher, but the market is there, the audience is there, who like these toys. And this one just recently unveiled, yes sir?
Do any of the vendors happen to have plushies, because, you know, I don't know
if this specific dealer's room has the plushies in stock. They are, yes?
They don't have plushies.
Oh, you checked? Okay, yeah. So this one is harder to find. If you have trouble finding them, you can definitely check the Robotech.com. The website, and look for the more obscure Toynami toys there. Ooh, getting feedback here. So now, also at the San Diego Comic-Con, Toynami recently unveiled the armored Veritex. This is the more obscure armor that you saw in that one episode during the Ms. Macross episode when Rick used and discarded this armor in this one episode, but man, it looked really badass. And since Toynami decided to do the tooling for these, they decided not to just do the version for Rick. They went ahead and did a blue version for Max, and they did a gold version for. Check online, and Toynami. These toys are actually they unveiled the stealth version at Comic-Con, and so they started with that one, but yeah, they do have these toys coming out, so definitely check out my Robotech.com.
That's exclusive, right?
That was a San Diego Comic-Con exclusive, so this specific one, if you weren't there in person, you might have to look into the eBay secondary market, yeah. And also, since a lot of folks missed the old Matchbox figures from back then. One thing that Toynami is working on is getting back into the action figure market with the Rotec toys. If you look at the limbs, it's a higher level articulation than the toys from back in the 80s had. So these are better quality articulation, and this is something that they're planning on having coming out next year. And also, Toynami is not our only license now that we've got expanded licensing going on as of late. We've got a new company called Kids Logic working with us on the new 6-inch scale toys. So they're going to have larger scale toys coming out. And this is the prototype sculpting that they have for Recunter going on right now, and they're planning that for next year as well. And here's a really hip company that we love working with. This is 80s Tees, and if you look here, this is one of their Veritech t-shirts that they have designed, and they're doing these really hip t-shirt designs, which and the quality is very good, that we think is awesome, including this one. This is one of the submissions, which, how many of you were fans since the old Macross days? How many of you remember this videotape? Well, we were kind of like, oh, is this a little bit too obscure? And they actually did kind of a pseudo crowdfunding thing where, okay, we'll go into production for this t-shirt if enough people pre-order this, and they put it up, and it got approved right away. I guess there were enough people who wanted that. So, and also, we noticed a lot of these at this convention. A lot of people were getting the new Rotec wall scrolls. CWS produces really awesome quality wall scrolls here. And here's some of the range that they have in their line. And we noticed a lot of them were being brought to the voice actors for autographs. Now, another classic category that's been around since the 80s, I think Palladium Books is actually one of our longest licensees we've ever had. They've been with us since the 80s. Except for a small gap when Robotech 3000 came out, they were very polite about it. They were like, thanks, but no thanks. And they skipped doing an RPG of Robotech 3000, but when Shadow Chronicles came out, they wanted to get back into the game, and they produced the Shadow Chronicles role-playing game, and then after the success of that, they started producing, based on the updated system, they did the Macross Saga, the Master Saga, source books, and they also did it for the new generation, and since a lot of fans were asking about the Sentinels era, instead of just calling it the Sentinels, they decided to kind of expand it into the Robotech Expeditionary Force. You know, that whole expeditionary era when the Robotech Expedition was away from Earth. And so they call this new source book the Robotech Expeditionary Source Marines. Yes, sir? Yes, yes, exactly. Yeah. So basically, you know, the Sentinel special that came out was more or less the Rick and Lisa wedding special.
Yeah.
At least this way, we can get more into the storyline of the Expeditionary Force, in, you know, at least through RPG gaming. Yeah. Now, how many of you have been getting into RPG miniatures? One thing that Palladium had been doing, which is not very well known, is they had been doing RPG miniatures for Robotech since the 90s,
yeah.
With these little pewter-style miniature pieces. And this is one of the most obscure, hardest to find collectibles for Robotech ever made. But since fans were asking for more of these, Palladium decided to get back into that with Robotech RPG Tactics. And they actually put it out for a Kickstarter campaign, which was highly successful. It raised $1.4 million. It was way past their original goal of $70,000 to fund the base set. And so with all the extra funding that they brought in through the Kickstarter, they decided to do all sorts of expansion sets and stretch goals with obscure pieces that were on screen maybe for mere seconds during the series. Well, they're making them all, you know, like the Jotun Valkyrie, which kind of looked Orgus-ish, or the Black Ghost mech that, you know, just briefly appeared in the Booby Trap episode, maybe like another few seconds here and there over the course of the series. And this is Kevin Sabita holding the finished product. So it's actually shipping. So these products are actually reaching customers now. And one nice thing about it is now on our social media, you know, a lot of fans who are receiving these are painting them up and doing custom poses and doing custom paint jobs and putting them on our websites. And so, you know, we highly encourage fans to like create their own versions of how they envision their, you know, section of the universe, and, you know, share it with others. Also novelizations for folks who have been into the McKinney novels. We had them, they've been in print for a very long time, but one of the things we've been doing is we've been migrating everything to electronic books. This has been very helpful in that some of the really obscure McKinney novels have been out of print for a long time, and fans were actually asking, you know, how do I get some of these more obscure books? And so now with ebooks, we have them available for all the e-readers, iPads, Amazon Kindle, so forth. And they've been reissuing the in-betweener the novels, The Lost Generation, which is in between the different generations of Robotech, such as the Zentradi Rebellion, which was in between the first and second generations, the Sentinels novels, and Before the Infinite Storm, which was in between the second and third generations. So all these hard-to-find novels are now back, not in print, but electronically available. And also End of the Circle, for those of you who are into an alternate McKinney version of the post-Sentinel storyline. And Robotech Comics as well. This is something that had actually predated Robotech. Just like the Macross video, the yellow Macross video that came out in 84, in the months before Robotech came out, there was a Macross comic book from Tomiko, which came out before then. And this was something I learned from Jerry Girovico, the original publisher of the company. He said, it's not pronounced Comico, it's pronounced Comico. That's how he pronounces it, so just so you guys know. And so these comics that have, more recent comics have been published by DC Comics and Wildstorm. And they were published in many different languages, including this version is the more recent reprinting for the Chinese market. But the newest comic series that came out was Robotech vs. Voltron. So for those of you who are really into 80s books, now, some of you are wondering, all right, how's that going to work, right? You know, Robotech is kind of hard, serious science fiction, and Voltron is a little bit more fantasy, you know, with black magic and so forth. How do you reconcile the two? And there were a lot of crossover proposals for Robotech before, and we had actually turned down some of the ideas. We were like, maybe not, we're going to pass on that. And so when I spoke with Jerry Corre, who at the time was the licensing manager for Voltron, our thought was, we don't want to just do this just for, you know, a crossover punchline, just for a cash-in, because oftentimes this happens where, you know, you have crossover universes. In the first issue, you just have a big beatdown bash between the crossover universes. It becomes a big mashup. And then the story runs out of steam, you know, what did they do? And so one of the things we wanted to do was make sure that the storyline was actually interesting, that it had weight to both sides, and you learned something about the characters on both sides. And so the result was actually, here's the first reaction we had from San Diego Comic-Con when we announced it a while back. This is our alternate universe, Roy Foker, who was, some folks were, reactions were LOL. Okay, so what I'm going to show you are real reactions leading up to San Diego Comic-Con that we pulled off our social media. So, Captain Roylock, that's with the eye patches. What? Hell yeah, Roy from the grave. My mind, it's blown. My two favorite animes in one. Woohoo. Let's see. Whoa, how does Woe? How into seven circles of hell for all the haters out there? You don't know how. This crossover is taking place. It's like having to choose between a filet or a ribeye, but this time you don't have to. You get both. Or who is higher ranking, Keith or Roy? Roy's going to kick the crap out of Lotor, and does Rick Hunter romance Princess Allura? Or probably rather see Chiron romance Prince Lotor. And then, nice, I'm so old, ha ha ha. Ron Paul warned us this would happen. I like that last one. That one was for real. And that one was actually immediate. That was a nice spontaneous remark from fans. This came out from Dynamite Entertainment in association with DC Comics. was a throwback to the classic aspects of the original 80s series. And we focus on the 3Ms to make this, for this series. Like, you know, the more recent Voltron series, you know, wanted to be a little bit more serious. They were downplaying little anime comical elements like the mice, but we were like, no, don't hide it, embrace it, you know. So, you know, our 3Ms were monsters and robots. Oops. Disappear, but mullets and mice. So that we decided to make sure that that was all in there. And here's some of the awesome artwork that we had from Elmer DeMasa. He was the artist of the series, and he did a great job. So we have an alternate universe Roy in which, just to give you a little bit of the premise, what if something happened to Rick and he disappeared from the Robotech universe, not Roy, and Roy actually went on to become a senior officer. So Roy is now Captain Roy Fokker, and he's now in a world where there is no Rick Hunter. So it's a very interesting kind of a what if where we got to flip the universe. So because of the events of what happened with the crossover, the universe on the Robotech side and Voltron side have both been affected and changed. And also, we get to explore into the backstory. If you're a Voltron fan, you always know that Princess Allura is the last member of the royal family because her late father is dead. And you're wondering, well, why did he end up dead? So we get to explore a little bit of the story of the days before what you see on the Voltron television series when King Alphor was not dead yet. And the family around her, such as Minister Koran, who becomes her advisor as a young man, and the mice. And then also on the Robotech side, you get to learn more about Roy's backstory, how he got adopted into the Hunter family. So we actually built up that backstory where Roy was actually adopted in because he was an orphan. Because if you read the Robotech graphic novel, you'll notice that he was actually raised by Rick Hunter's father. And his father was nowhere to be seen because in this backstory that we developed, you get to read about in the series, their respective fathers were actually co-pilots during Operation Desert Storm, and only one made it back, and they had a pact between them. If something happened to one of them, one would promise to take care of the other son. And so hence, that's why Roy... Yes, yes, sir.
Wasn't there like a civil war previous to the spaceship crashing into the Red Cross Island? That's why it became
peaceful? Well, it was some of the comic series kind of made it more like the definitions varied from Civil War to World War III. Like, there were different comics that called it different things. But I think the television series that just simply had it as there was kind of like a global worldwide warfare going on where the world was falling apart at the time. And so here's one of the things that happened to Robotech that we actually have to acknowledge is that Robotech is actually caught up to the future. And so between 1985 and 2009, all the events between 1985 and 2009 was up for speculation. But now, when this comic series was coming out, we know everything that happened between 1985 and 2009. So we know that Barack Obama was presiding as president when an alien spacecraft crashed on Macross Island in the South Pacific in 2009. Now, getting back to the subject, right? getting back to the subject at hand. So, you know, there was all this global worldwide warfare and so forth. And so in the time frame in earlier in the 90s, at least we knew, okay, well, you know, who would be flying around in an F-14 around this time? Okay, well, you know, Operation Desert Storm fits the dates and fits the bill. So hence we were able to fit this backstory in and make it kind of fit with the backstory, the loose ends that we had from before. Anything bad that happens after 2016, we can blame on whoever gets elected then. Okay.
All right.
Well, you know, this is something that happens to all. All right.
That's why we all get that hair.
This is a good example of why comic book, you know, sci-fi fantasy universes always have to be rebooted generation to generation. You know, everybody goes, no, don't reboot my universe. I like it the way it is. But it's inevitable, because what happened is, if you look at the original Iron Man, the reason why Tony Stark had to escape, evade capture, and the reason why he had to repair himself after his injuries was because he was captured by the Viet Cong while he was in Southeast Asia. And of course, in today's era, that story wouldn't fit anymore, and so hence they changed the Viet Cong to mercenaries in Afghanistan. So, you know, the world had to change to fit, you know, the times.
Yeah, but do you think they're going to include things like crippling alcohol?
Well, you know, I'm not going to speculate about what's going to happen with future iterations of Robotech, but that's, you know, current worldviews, you know, this is something that always have to be kept in mind when doing new adaptations, you know, like the Robotech live action, which we'll touch into in a little bit. So, these are some of the designs that Elmer Damaso did for the Robotech Voltron series. He actually did some really nice work. Like, he created fast packs for Voltron, and because Voltron is so much bigger than Veritech, because it's actually five mechs merged into one, he had to design a super duper fast pack.
He put down a
regular Veritech? No, it would be like a fast pack with a Veritech attached to it.
Yeah.
And actually, here you see the scope of the size of Voltron compared to his Entradi mech right here. So this is one of those scenes we got going on in there. And here's a scene of SDF-1 actually ending up in the Voltron universe. So basically, the timelines have become basically smooshed together.
Yeah.
And so different characters in different situations are trying to find out how to resolve everything back together and find out what the cause of it was in the first place. And here's a scene in which Chiron actually tries to steal one of the lion mechs. And so that's a little taste of what we've got coming up. Now, you can get it right now as individual issues from Comixology. But if you like things in print, there's a trade paperback coming out. It was originally scheduled for December, but Dynamite and DC actually pushed the schedule up. I believe they're supposed to be shipping out at the end of this month. So either at the very end of this month or the beginning of October, you should be seeing these trade paperbacks coming out. So, and we've got some nice additional material, like behind-the-scenes sketches, notes about the characters and all this stuff, backgrounds. All in this trade paperback, so if you've missed the individual issues, this is like the book to collect. And just to give you this goes in with our live-action licensing information, which I'll go into more detail later. DC Comics has been a long-time wonderful partner with us in terms of producing these Robotech comics, but because our live-action license with the Warner Brothers has come to an end, our comic book license with DC, which is the division of Warner Brothers, is coming to an end at the end of this year. So next year, be prepared. We're going to be announcing a new comic book partner that we're partnering with for new Robotech comics coming out next year.
You already have a comic book partner?
Oh?
You already have a comic book partner?
Oh, no. Our comic book partner is still DC Comics. As you can tell from this Voltron book coming out, we're still working with them through the end of this year. But once the end of this year comes and goes, that long-time license is expiring, and we're going to have a new party coming in to develop new Robotech comics after that. But we can't announce that yet. You know, we're not going to announce who it is.
I won't tell anyone.
All right, so everybody promises you're going to keep all those cameras to yourself and you're going to sit on the 731st, right? All right, I trust you all. So, you know, as I learned from Ellen Stern earlier today, the name of the ones who are going to license the Robotech, the new Robotech series?
Oh, yeah.
The new licensee is going to be a comic book company, okay?
Whoa!
Just like when Helen Stern says, yeah, the name of my character was her. Alright, so Robotech soundtracks. Now, this is a great new character. This is the original LP from back in the 80s. How many of you love vinyl? Alright, you love vinyl. Okay, but you know, even with things going digital, you know, through Apple iTunes, how many of you would let go of your CD collection with your cold dead fingers.
Yes.
So, when we digitally remastered the newer audio releases for the Rotech Music, we actually decided to go back to the original master record. This is actually a funny pun here. Unintentional. Rotech Master, get it? So this is the reverse side of it. Now, this tape shows, you know, all the original recordings, all the sessions, the names of the engineers, everyone involved in recording this. Now, what was interesting was when we were going into our archives, the tape on the left was what the previous soundtracks were made from. It was a quarter-inch tape, and it was cataloged with a certain amount of tracks. Funny thing was, in the years afterwards, we found another master tape. It had the same catalog number. And this is one of the reasons why we didn't know there was any difference. It was in the catalog under the same catalog number, and it had the same it had the same tracks on it, the same songs on it. So, but when somebody actually physically looked at it and said, you know what, there's something different about this tape. So we actually opened both tapes, and the left is the is that a quarter or a half inch? It's like a half inch. Okay, so that's a half inch tape on the left, and that's a 2-inch tape on the right. So it requires a tape player that's 2 inches wide. And we were wondering what was different, so we sent it to an analog tape restoration house. There was a restoration studio, which actually restores music from the 70s for bands like Chicago. And so we went there, and the guy knew exactly what to do about restoring the tape. And here's a closer view. And this was a tape recorder that he had to put it through. And there were only two of these working, this model, left in North America. And I asked him, how do you know that there's only two of them working left? And he goes, oh yeah, the guy who was the other one and I, we know each other. So, actually, funny thing is, we found another 2-inch tape, though it wasn't the same model, so it doesn't count, but yeah, the number of these tape decks that can read these giant tapes, I think you can just count with the number of fingers on your hand. But you see those gauges there? You notice that 23 out of 24 of them are lit, which means that tape had 23 tracks of data coming off the analog tracks. And we found out that they were actually 23 instruments isolated. So this was in the old analog days when you kept your data separate from one another. That was how to do it. That's how they mastered these songs. And we were flabbergasted because what we found out with this, we could do karaoke versions. So that leads to what we have here, the Rotech 30th Anniversary soundtrack. What we've done with certain key songs by Lindman May, and actually one huge request that we had was the Together song by Minmay and Janice. A lot of Rotech fans were actually using that Together song at their wedding because that was used on the Rick and Lisa wedding. And so now, because we have a karaoke version of Together, if you want to have your groomsmen and bridesmaids sing that song at your upcoming weddings, you can now. So just let you guys know. So this is the most complete CD set so far that we have. Here we go.
Woohoo!
It's three CDs, 116 tracks. This is the biggest collection of Rotech music that we have to date in one package.
Does it have Lisa singing in the bar?
No, that was actually something we were looking for.
Darn.
Unfortunately, that was not recorded during one of the music sessions. Was that recorded in the booth?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I got a question for you. Do you remember how that came about? Like, how were you given direction for how to sing that? Did they give you reference, like the original?
He said
music?
I was unhappy and drunk. And I'm like, I can do that.
But you were actually singing the tune accurately. So did they give you like a recording of Rebecca's version of the song before you had to sing it?
I think I did. They didn't give it to me.
Oh.
But I think they just like, okay, here's hers. I think they played it for me a couple times.
Uh-huh.
And also because in the course of a recording, one way or the other, I'd have to listen to her sing it. I don't know, one way or another, I'd have to, oh, here she goes again. You know, for more time. So it kind of got stuck in my head anyway. But yeah, just before I did it, they played to make sure I could, yeah.
Well, we thought we had almost everything. But what we're going to do is we're going to start up a new list of stuff to look for the 40th anniversary.
Lisa singing in the bar.
Can you sing it for us now?
I do have to say that is one of the most heartbreaking scenes in the whole series.
Yeah. Yeah.
I need the karaoke version.
Oh, okay. Well, all right, let me play a couple of samples from the new soundtrack I've got here for you. Sentinels tunes that was not on any of the previous CDs before. And so, even though there was some Sentinels music in previous Rotech soundtracks, a lot of fans said, well, there's a lot of music that's actually missing. And what's interesting was when we went into the Sentinels master tapes, we found that they didn't record music just for that 90-minute special. We found that they recorded music for the whole TV series. And so there was a lot of music that went unused that was intended for the Sentinels TV series if it had been completed. And so that's actually on the CD set here. So you have more Sentinels music than you had before. Yes?
I'm curious, did you guys remix from the masters or did you just transfer?
Some of them were just direct transfers where the mix was complete. We just did a direct transfer. Some of them we remixed a little bit, like I think some of Min Mei's tracks were auto-tuned just a little bit, just to get her a little bit back on tune, because that technology was available to us now. But I think in We Will Win was probably the most work that we did in terms of remastering the mix completely. The reason is that we found from the original musical notes that Obi Amunichi had written out, he had actually written out We Will Win with three verses and three choruses, but he only used two out of the three. And then in one of the work tapes that Reba West had, we found that she had the third stanza, or the third chorus. And we were like, where did you get this? She goes, oh yeah, I recorded all this many different times and they were mixing it together, but I guess when they were mixing it together, they decided to just finish it with just two choruses because with the third, it became too long and they couldn't use it in the show, and it was never used in the television series. And so what we did, we have this now extended version of the We Will Win song, where we actually took the third chorus, and we actually had to mix it back in, because the mix was finished with only two, and the third chorus was actually an unfinished mix. And we actually sent it to Opio's son, Keely Minucci, had him give us some feedback, and we also worked with Randall Rummage, who was the producer of the Sentinels music, having him check our music mix to make sure that it was all done right. And I think the results actually came out pretty well. So it's almost like listening to new music that feels familiar, but you hadn't heard before. Actually, here's another one. There's some Min Mei songs that Reba West had recorded that were never used because they were actually written originally for the Lancer character. And then, as Mimi, she had sung it. So here's one called The Way to Love. You know, it's a Lancer song, so I know the tune, but oh my goodness, it's Min Mei singing it instead. Yeah, so that's also on there. So, very importantly, Robotech on video. How many of you guys suffered through trying to track down every single VHS back then? And, of course, we got a lot of feedback from Pierre Bernard as well, who complained how there was all these different boxes. Why can't we just have one big box set to rule them all? And it was also the Sentinels, these little obscure sections of Rotec that are hard to find. And we did a digital remaster of the Sentinels. Not only did we clean up the picture, you get more of the picture in the remastered version. And obscure projects that didn't work so well, like Rotec 2000. And, oh yeah, Rotec the Shadow Chronicles and Love, Love, Alive. How many of you are familiar with Love, Love, Alive?
Kind of?
All right, here. We'll play a little preview of it. Such as Greg Smirnoff, the voice of Scott Bernard, and we have Frank Catalano here in the background there, the voice of Rand, and here we have Greg Smirnoff recording, Cam Clark recording, which we played earlier, as reprising his role as Lancer, and we also brought in actors who had left the industry, such as Susie London, who came back to play Rook again, and Barbara Goodson, who plays the other infant princess, Sarah, and Alexander Kenworthy, who came back to play the Regis. So it was like bringing that whole cast back together for an additional episode of The New Generation. And so one of the things that happened with the original episode is that the pacing of it was fairly slow. And I'm going to give you an example of it. You know, have you ever watched a lot of the Evangelion episodes where the pacing is really slow and you get a lot of the background scenes where... I just like to throw this out as an example, like Shinji's waiting at a bus stop and he just waits there and you see the shimmering of the trees away and you'll hear the crickets in the background and maybe a bus will come by and then it goes and he doesn't even get on, you know. So you'll see a lot of scenes kind of like that in anime. But, and so there were some scenes paced a little bit like that in Love, Love, Live, and we wanted to pick up the pacing without modifying the original content too much, and so Here, I'll show you one of the original scenes. It must be the Love Live Alive. You're really looking forward to an hour of that, right? Okay, now, here after we did the digital restoration and we actually added in the Robotech music and we did a little nip and tuck with editorial, you'll notice that the scene is relatively unchanged but it has a completely different feel to it. Animatics for an action sequence, and here we're going to juxtapose it with the cross dissolve into the cell animation style that evolved into. Happy to get this from the archives. Yeah, one of the production designers really was into 80s rock.
Awesome.
And so now, just like Pierre Bernard suggested, it's all in one giant 20-disc box set. This has everything in there today. It has The Shadow Chronicles, Love Live Alive, The Sentinels, all 85 of the remastered episodes. And for those of you who watched the early broadcast, it has some of the early broadcast versions. Where the sound mix actually changed between the first broadcast and the reruns. There's some fans who noticed the difference, and so for those of you who are in for a little treat, that's in the DVD extras too. And it has a lot of bonus features where we talk with the actors about the making of Robotech, including the narrator. We thought he was dead. many folks thought he had passed on. And I asked some of the voice actors, how do you know that he's not with us anymore? And they said, back in 85, we thought he had one foot in the grave back then. But then we found out that he was still around. And just to give you an idea of how long his career goes back, one of his early voiceover jobs was doing the Lucille Ball Show. But we found out he hadn't passed on, and we said, oh, happened? He goes, well, I wasn't dead, I was just laid up, I just threw out my hip, that's all, everybody's thinking I'm dead.
Under one of the mixing.
He has a Midwestern accent, I think he's from Nebraska, and funny thing was, the first time we brought him in, he didn't sound anything like he did as the narrator of Robotech. Greg said, I know that, because he had worked with him before, he goes, don't worry, I'll coach him back into his original voice. So here, we'll give you some little backstory on that. So what was the student film about? I said it was about Robotech. And the faculty administrator said, oh, Robotech? Oh, yeah, that one we saved. Yeah, we thought that one So, they didn't have the expense to save most of the, student homework back then, but that one specific piece they did save, and so we were able to restore it and add it into the DVD extras for this. And let's see, next in the pipeline, this is something that Melanie worked with us is called Deep Sea 7. This is a new anime, a futuristic anime story about global warming having submerged much of the world underwater. But it's not quite like Waterworld, so it's hip teenage kids who have access to multi-million-dollar futuristic submarines chasing after treasure sunken under the ocean in the future. But it's voice directed by Greg Smega, who was one of the original voice directors of Robotech. And he also voices one of the main characters. And you also worked with him on this project.
Yes, I did the character of Mona, who's sort of like a female Arnold Schwarzenegger. A little different for me, huh? And and she's got, she's muscle bound, but she's also got her feminine side. whenever the captain comes in, she gets all like, and if you mess with her, she's the cook. So if you criticize her cooking, she will kill you. So, yeah.
Do you think you got the moment partially because of, like, your style of delivery, you know, having that military style again, kind of like what led to you?
I don't know. Mona's a little more street. Yeah, you know. And that's, she's got, you know, the sleeveless t-shirt and she's a little military, yeah, but she's also just rough edges
she
can kick everybody's ass, you know. So it's great fun to play her because not me, definitely not me.
Well, I think, we have a little scene here that we can play for you from Deep Sea 7. And just to give you, just to prepare you, even though it's futuristic, there's also a humor streak to it. So here we go. Finalized with Sony was the producers of 300. We have Gianni Nunari and Mark Canton, the producers of 300, working on it, and we have Michael Gordon, the writer of 300, working on this. And you notice how among the comic book adaptations, you know, that was highly regarded and was a huge hit. And so they're taking Robotech very seriously. They want to do a good adaptation. And they also brought in a director. They didn't want to just bring in any director. They wanted to get a established big action movie director. And they brought in James Wan, the director of Fast and Furious 7.
Oh.
So, which was one of the few movies that made $1 billion within the last year. So, he's working on it, and one of the things about him is he's very familiar with the franchise, and he's taking it also very seriously, and he wants to make a very good film. You know, he wants it to kick ass, and so we are very much looking forward to the movies that they have going on the live-action movie film. Now, we've got a little message recording at San Diego Comic-Con for all the fans, and so we're going to play this back for you.
I'm Mark Canton, producer of Robotech. I'm sorry I can't be there to share this great day with all of you. Along with my partner, Johnny Nunnery, we are thrilled to be involved in the amazing future of Robotech. As I'm sure you all know, the legendary Frank Iguama and his company, Harmony Gold, has had the rights for many, many years. Johnny and myself asked our friend and colleague, Michael Gordon, who wrote 300, to join us on this. And we're particularly excited because of the addition of not only Michael, but the unbelievably talented young maestro director, James Wan, fresh off of Furious 7, who's come aboard to create this amazing Robotech world and franchise, and there's nothing that Johnny and I have done that we're more excited about. Whether it's 300 or Immortals or all the other movies we've been fortunate and blessed enough to make in our careers, this is the culmination, going back to Batman with Tim Burton, or Men in Black, or Starship Troopers, or so many other amazing movies and franchises. We're very proud to have Sony as our partners. For me, it's the first time back at Sony in many years. Be prepared, because the original Robotech is coming. It's not like anything anyone would have seen before. Thanks for your time, and hopefully next year we'll all be sitting together in Comic-Con.